I'm Jeremy Greer.
And I'm Gary Butterfield.
And this is Days of Future Cast, the podcast where we talk about a bunch of stuff Marvel. We are kind of in the middle of an Avengers versus X-Men run, but we've taken a break to talk about the latest and greatest in the MCU. We just wrapped up an episode on the TV show Loki, and now we're talking about the theatrical big budget release. Finally, Gary, it's here, the Black Widow movie. Would you let the Black Widow kick your ass? Would you let her break your neck? Yes or no?
Now, you know, I don't go in for
in
that
in a sex
whole,
way. It's definitely a sex way. Yeah, but yeah.
No, I don't really understand the way the youths want to die and think that it'll make them horny. I think that if the Black Widow was literally stepping on my neck, I would want to breathe. Like, my instincts would kick in.
Kinky.
And I, yeah, I don't think the blood would rush to my dick. I think that I get a fight or flight response from not getting enough blood to my brain. And I think I'd be really scared more than anything. And I think it'd be very hard for me to get a boner after that.
Okay. Well,
so no is my answer.
Interesting.
How about you?
I'm pretty ambivalent. Like, if somebody just wants to come along and end me at this point, I'd be okay. I kind of don't want it to be.
But it wouldn't turn you on. Like, it'd be fine. Mm-hmm. But it's like purely transactional.
Exactly.
It's like a notary.
Exactly. Sign here. Here's my driver's license. Yeah. And do I just lay here for you to stamp on me, or
not
do you want to
kind of stamp?
Do you want to knock me down? Okay. Here's the thing. I would want her to do the weird. I'm going to jump in the air, grab you with my legs, and then like put you on the ground thing that she does in every single fight scene. So that's. I guess I would want that thing. I'd be like, oh, this is neat. Oh, I'm dead. Yeah. Okay, this is the last thing that I saw.
It would hurt a lot, and for a second it would be kind of fun.
Yeah.
The other thing I think about whenever people are getting horny about that kind of thing is how even the most delectable crotch probably smells horrible after exercising in leather.
Sure.
Like, for a lot, you know, so like getting that leg thing done to you would probably be like a real UFC style experience, you know, like in terms of crotch smell.
Yeah, I can see that, but we really can take the joy out of anything, huh? Here's people just out there wanting to get horny, and we're like, well, do you know that's gonna smell bad? And people are like, yeah, and like, it's not fun eating ass either, but like, we jerk off to it all the time, and I'm like,
but
oh,
we do it. Yeah, but we brag about it on Twitter 24/7. I don't get the I want this lady to kill me thing. You could just sit on your face. It doesn't have to be a murder.
Yeah.
That's a sex act. It's great. We're talking about the Black Widow.
Should change the subject. Yeah, this is the Black Widow movie that probably should have come out 4 or 5 years ago. And it's pretty good. Like,
it's not bad. It's felt good to, like, this is the first movie I saw since 2019's Cats in the theater.
Way to end it.
Yep. So I went to a theater. It was barely occupied. I went in a matinee. I sat like 20 feet away from anybody. And I felt really good. It felt really good to go see a superhero movie where superheroes punch each other in a big air conditioned room in the dark.
Sure.
And the fact that it was like competent, like I would put this in the middle, you know, this, the thing I texted you after this, like, I like this about as much as I liked Captain Marvel.
Okay.
And I'm not just like, oh, the ladies, you know, it's not that. I just, you know, I thought it was good and fun. It just wasn't it wasn't in my revelatory, like, super good, you know, Marvel tier.
Yeah.
Better than like a Doctor Strange, better than an Ant-Man one.
It's weird seeing this around the time that we're watching and talking about Loki, because it just, we were joking about phases in the last episode, like, it just couldn't be any more clear that these belong in like two totally separate eras of Marvel. Like, it feels like that they're just so far removed from one another, and what they're trying to do, the way that they're trying to present it being done, like the stylistic stuff, like, this feels very much like a, you know, we're in the Iron Man 2 era of Marvel movies, which, like, hey, we have to have the big CGI ending, we have to have the funny jokes about stuff that is maybe problematic but also maybe not problematic, you know, that kind of stuff, and it's all executed well. And once again, like, the side performances I think carry this. I've never really been a huge fan of Scarlett Johansson's Black Widow because they'd never really given her a whole lot to do, but even then I just never really I never really bonded with her as the character at all. But Florence Pugh and David, I almost said Harbor, thank you. It's not Solid Harbor. Snake, but the guy from Stranger Things. They really kind of steal the show in a good way. Like, I think they do a really good job. But it feels very much like a by the numbers MCU film from, you know, 4 or 5 years ago. And I really think if we had gotten it 4 or 5 years ago, I may have had more interest in like her entire thing in Endgame. Like I kind of didn't care about her whole situation in Endgame at all. So
yeah, I would agree with that. Like when, you know, it is a thing where this almost to me felt like a peek into an alternate MCU, whereas instead of going cosmic, it followed Winter Soldier.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and we had a lot more of these kind of street level espionage geopolitical things. Like it felt like a worse Winter Soldier to me.
Absolutely.
You know, mm-hmm. like the scale and stakes were definitely lower, not least of which because we know the main character dies. So we know they live here, but we know that they die later. You know, it ended up like having that prequel energy. I think that if it had come out, you know, in sequence, in chronology, like this is happens during the events of Civil War, basically. If this had happened around then, it would have made a lot more sense, both in terms of story and making me care about Natasha, and then also making me, you know, filling out that era of Marvel a little bit better in terms of representing this side of things.
Yeah. I went in kind of thinking I had very low expectations for this movie. Mm-hmm. I just watching the trailers and stuff, just a lot of like explosions and flippies and, you know, flying through midair. And I'm like, I don't really like, I feel like, you know, watch, like looking at future trailers for Marvel stuff and then looking at this, I was like, okay. Like, it just feels like a throwback almost. Like, are we at the point where we're doing retro stuff now, Marvel? Like, is that what we're doing? Like, this feels very much like, you know, oh, I'm going to do the 8-bit platformer in the middle on the PlayStation era or something.
Yeah. It definitely has some throwback energy.
And
like 100%.
But like what I got was like perfectly competent. I apparently am the only person in the world. I don't know what your perception of this, but the intro song, which is the kind of slowed down cover of Smells Like Teen Spirit, I thought, like, I almost laughed. Like, I thought it was really, really corny.
You think you're the only person in the world? Like, hold up, Jeremy. Are there other people who are like that fucking owns?
Dude, like, the fucking TikTok loves that shit. They love it. Like I've seen so many people on TikTok and on Twitter saying, like, that was the coolest intro that I've ever seen to any MCU movie or maybe any movie ever. And I'm like, who are you? Like,
my jaw's on the fucking floor. Are you out of, like,
I'm not joking.
No wonder I don't have a TikTok.
This is not exaggeration. Like, this is actual stuff that I saw.
The kids are not all right. Go find someone to step on your neck, TikTokers. like get some better taste in sad covers.
Oh, believe me, that was point two. After that was like Florence Pugh I want Florence Pugh to step on my neck, and I love this cover of Nirvana Smells Like Teen Spirit.
God. Yeah, maybe the future is, maybe we're not gonna do okay.
Yeah.
That's wild. I thought that was cheesy and shitty. Like, all the things I thought in this movie that sucked were the things that MCU haters hate because they're super predictable. Like, every single thing that happens in the cold open comes back in a way that made me want to die.
Yeah.
Like, you know, oh, I have to pull up on the throttle. Here's the book. Oh, you taught me, you know, oh, you're upside. We're both upside down. You know, like every single line from that comes back in a way that I thought was like filled me with repulsion.
You know what it is? It is. And the reason that I reacted probably as strongly as you did on it, because it's the fucking Zack Snyder DC movies. It's exactly that. Yeah. Like, it's like, oh, I only have, you know, 120 minutes to make you care about this character for the end of it. So I have to fill the beginning with end jokes. Hopefully you'll forget about them in 70 minutes and then remind you of it when it's at a real poignant time when, you know, fucking Hallelujah is playing or something. It wasn't quite that bad, but exactly that. Like,
when a sad cover of Drain You is playing.
We talked about this in Loki, you know, having the time to develop Captain America made everything about Captain America towards the end of that series great. And it's just the opposite here. Like, they've done basically nothing to develop Natasha as a person, except to say that for her to tell Bruce that she's a monster because she can't have children. And then now we have like this whole family union thing, which rung extremely false to me throughout the entire movie.
Mm.
So
Yeah. And it's kind of the, you know, the criticism or the response to this movie are all pretty universally like, that's the good part, you know, is the family stuff. And like, I could see a universe in which that was the case, you know, like we were talking about the last episode about how at its worst, like MCU movies are a billion years long, but also feel like they don't have enough time for everything. Like everyone complained about the finale to Black Widow. I kind of liked the idea of like the family spy plan, you know, like them going through and exhibiting these roles and teaming up as a family to do this. It just, we didn't get enough time to put it forward. And the stuff that we did have before that did ring really silly.
Yeah.
To me, like the scene at the dinner table where they're all arguing about whether it was true or false, that they were really a family. Like my dude, like, you know, David Harbour, you have to reckon with the fact that you sold your daughters into slavery. So, you know, you did make them slaves. You sent them away to this thing. And like, there's that really incredibly cold scene in the cold open where you come up and calm them down so military dudes can go jab their necks.
Yes.
With shit. Like, you have to reckon with this more. Like, I understand you're supposed to be a comical dumbass, and that's a little bit of your character, but I didn't understand why anyone was forgiving anyone.
Exactly.
In this.
And like, there was there's a little bit of pathos where Yelena is in that same scene is like, you know, I thought it was real. Like, was I the only one who didn't recognize? Like, you all were my family because she was the youngest of the group. And I thought that that had some emotional resonance. And that was like, oh, shit, that really does suck for her. Like, if this is the first time that she's maybe having the realization that they don't give a shit about you. Like, she thought she, you know, oh, it was only because of the country that they pulled my family out part. Like, it was nobody gave a shit about one another. Like, you were all spies to begin with. Like, nobody had feelings. So why are we doing this dinner table shenanigans where everybody is like, I'm supposed to feel like you're a family unit or something, or give you a big hug? Or whatever. Like, the family stuff rang really, really hollow to me, even though, as I said, like, the Yelena and David Harbour, whose name I cannot, Red Guardian or whatever, like, I thought they were the highlight of the movie. Like, when they got to do stuff that wasn't related to Black Widow, I was like, really excited.
What's really funny about Red Guardian in this movie is that he doesn't do shit. Like, he shows up, he does some comic relief, but just gets trounced in every scene that he does things. Like, they kind of broke, like, in terms of their plan, they broke him out of prison to tell them where their mom was.
Yeah.
You know, and he puts on a costume, gets darted, shows up, gets beaten up by the Taskmaster.
That's it.
And that's it. That's it.
So. I want to roll back something I said just a minute ago, because I said that, like, when Yelena was doing anything not related to the Black Widow, I actually really did like the relationship between the two sisters in this quite a bit.
I thought that was good too.
They do the kind of cheesy thing that I don't particularly care for in movies, where like the two people who haven't seen each other in a long time, like, they start off with a huge fight and then they're like, okay, we're cool now, let's have drinks or whatever. Like, you were just trying, you just put me through a wall. Like, why can't we say hi? But also, like, that was a really cool fight scene, so I can't like complain too much. Like, it was okay. But I really do think Florence Pugh as Yelena, like, steals the show. She's fucking hilarious. She's a badass. She's constantly making fun of Black Widow for being an Avenger, constantly making fun of the Avengers as altogether. Like, just really, really funny.
Yeah. Well, and it's Florence Pugh, so she gets to do that big sad frown, you know, that she does, that I love so much.
Yeah.
Oh, Midsummer's happening.
Oh,
like, she's cheating on
my
me.
Boyfriend's a she bear. So he's sad. On fire. Oh.
Yeah. Oh, she gets so sad. It's very funny.
They told me he wouldn't feel anything. Oh.
Oh. I love super sad Florence Pugh, and I want that energy in our Dark Avengers Thunderbolts. You know.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Like, John Walker walks up, says some kind of bullshit. She just goes, makes fun of him, and then does the, she's great. And I'm glad that, like, this is another cool way that I feel like the movies fuck around with the comics. Like, the fact that there have been a billion Black Widows means that just because this character died and Scarlett Johansson, you know, wants a lot of money now, doesn't mean that we can't have a Black Widow.
Because
we'll just have a different one. Because there's a million of all these things. Because comics, we have all this stuff to pull from, you know? That kind of ties into the end and, like, the post-credits thing. Which I wanted to ask, but before we got into that, I wanted to ask you what you thought of this representation of Taskmaster.
I'm okay with
it. And how the movie handled that.
I'm okay with it. I wish there had been more Taskmaster, and I wish that the Taskmaster had fought with, like, more of the Avengers, like kind of fighting style, that kind of thing. Like they played with it a little bit with the shield, but like I really wanted to see like Captain America mode, Hawkeye mode, Iron Man mode. Like I wanted it to be like that dude had studied, or that chick had studied all of the Avengers and was bringing that to bear against the Black Widow. And I think Black Widow only fights Taskmaster once, if I'm remembering right. Mm-hmm. And
like one real fight, yeah. And then one kind of like, I don't want to hurt you.
Exactly. Yeah.
Semi-fight.
So I wasn't, I'm fine with the changes as far as from the comic book or whatever, because I'm not like seriously invested in the comic book Taskmaster or anything. Like,
yeah, Taskhead.
Not a Taskhead. No, not from a long time. And we've since changed the Facebook name from Masturbators for obvious reasons. But we, I wanted Taskmaster to be what he is, what they were in the comics, right? Like I want the Taskmaster to actually like copy moves, and that's the thing, like, mm-hmm. besides the shield, like that didn't really exist, and I was kind of bummed about that.
There's only a couple of times like he does the Black Panther claw thing,
yeah
for a second. Mm-hmm. There's only a couple of them, but I wanted a little bit more of that too. I'm glad that she's still around.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You know, because the let's say you know, she gets deprogrammed, and then now we have a Taskmaster. Taskmaster would be a really good Dark Avenger as well. You know, historically, like ends up playing one of those, would be a good recruit eventually,
or even like a gray, you know, like a gray level superhero who the Avengers bring on to fight the Dark Avengers, right? Like, it'd be that yeah. kind of morally in the middle of, if you pay me enough, I'll fight whoever you want me to, kind of situation. I don't, you know,
yes.
I don't know how she gets deprogrammed to get to that point, but I feel like it could go either way with it, and I would be into it.
Yeah, does it red stuff, red gas?
Yeah, exactly.
I really wanted a little bit more too. What ended up working for me a little bit more than I thought, because, you know, we were talking about villains and stuff, and that's a henchman, you know, the Taskmaster in this, and worked okay as far as a henchman. Something that I didn't expect to work, but I actually really liked, was exactly how fucking vile the dude was, the Red Room guy.
Mm-hmm.
That performance worked for me as just like fucking disgusting. There's like a line in it where he's like, I'm making use of the only natural resource we have too much of, girls.
Yeah.
And I was just like, man, that's grody. It reminded me of Game of Thrones stuff where like, there's that Game of Thrones thing where Cersei's like, you know, what is it? Prince Oberyn is like, you know, we don't abuse little girls in Sunspear. And he's like, no, she's like, no, they abuse little girls everywhere. You know, just like 100% competent,
mm-hmm.
or confident in that. It reminded me of that.
Yeah. The guy felt like it was almost like a parody of like the Harvey Weinsteins, right? Like it was that, it almost felt like that's sure. what they were going after. Even going after, like, I think you can have a read into that of being like, oh, these are the Marvel executives that, you know, very publicly said like, oh, women can't carry superhero movies. And that's the reason we didn't get this movie 4 or 5 years ago. And we're getting in 2021 post Wonder Woman. Yeah. We're like just so misogynistic, so abusive. So we control everything. We can make you do whatever we want to. And yeah, that it worked for me. I thought the floating carrier in the sky thing was so dumb. I'm sorry. Like
it's kind of weird that they just also had a helicarrier.
Yeah. Like I feel like SHIELD at some point should, like, I don't know, man. Like, I'm not saying we need to put armor across around the world and create an Ultron. I'm just saying, like, I mean, you guys have radar, right? Like, but just figure out how many helicarriers we have around running around.
Yeah. If you can see satellites, you can see this.
Yeah.
You know, come on. Yeah, I thought that was a little bit silly as well. I wanted, you know, a better thing than that. It also meant like it was gonna crash, because that's what helicarriers
exactly.
do.
Mm-hmm.
And led to, you know, the ticking clock in the finale of this that I was a bit of a letdown.
Yeah.
You know, that could have been a lot better, even though, you know, despite the fact that I had moments that I really liked.
If you're gonna give me like a helicarrier like this, you need to give me the bureaucracy of the shield. Like, I would be here for this if it was Russian bureaucracy a la like Chernobyl, right? But if you're gonna put like a figurehead on that has like a pinky ring that's a gold and diamond, like I can't handle it. Like, I'm checking
you
out.
You got the one dude with the pinky ring, and then a room full of girls doing choreographed fights.
Yes,
and that's everything in this huge, and then a surgery room. You know, but it did not feel like a place at all.
Exactly. Yeah.
And, you know, and there would have been, the editor in me is like, oh, there would have been ways to do that. Like, there would have been ways to get here quicker. to extend this, like, you know, put the family talk when they're all in prison, you know, before they separate them out or something like that, you know, do like there could have been a way to do a little bit more of showing how this worked, that I would have appreciated.
I will say, I think the highlight of the movie for me, was probably, in terms of action scenes, it was probably the prison break, which had been shown in the trailers, and I'd kind of reacted negatively against, because I was like, oh, we're just in white outfits and we're gonna jump around the snow or whatever. But it ended up being extremely cool. And, you know, for all that he's, you can kind of, the Red Guardian is at his best when he's just being a complete pompous asshole. And like moments where he's doing the arm wrestling thing and telling stories about Captain America, which are definitely not true, were absolutely hilarious. And they were just great.
Oh, that was great. Yeah. Karl Marx knuckle tattoos.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Like that's very funny.
And I love the moment where they finally escape, and like he's like, Natasha, hang back, Natasha, listen, I really want to talk to you. And then like she's like, what? And like expecting some sort of moment, he's like, has Captain America said anything about me? And I just
mentioned to me.
It's so good.
Well, again, like I mentioned this last episode, how cool would it be if like he has fought Captain America, he just doesn't know.
Exactly. Yeah.
You know, he's fought one of the other ones.
He doesn't see race. He's Russian. We're not racist.
All Americans look the same to me.
You're all capitalist pigs. I don't care what color you are.
One of the things that was literally making me think about, though, is that like our version of the MCU, we had Captain America in the 60s and then a big period of nothing, you know, and then Iron Man shows up. And like this is the first movie, I think, that implies there was something in that time period, even if it was just in like Russia.
Yeah.
You know, even if he's delusional, like he did have a costume. He was a costume superhero and a super soldier in the 80s and 90s.
Absolutely.
You know, I mean, I guess we have Captain Marvel in the 90s as well, but that's, you know, again, that's disconnected because of space shit. You know, but it is interesting, the idea of, you know, I mentioned this last episode, and the two things, you know, Loki and Black Widow, the thing they dovetail together is the idea of opening up the door to exploring these different time periods. You know, I would watch, you know, movies with, I would watch the movie that was Captain America versus the Red Guardian, you know, or watch the Disney Plus show that was that, do it on the cheap, make it animated.
Yeah.
You know, fuck it. And I'll watch those stories. I think that's a cool idea.
I mean, it's just called The Americans, and it's, you could just go watch it right now, but like I would watch a like six episode miniseries of the spy family living in America, like leading up to them having to leave at the last minute or whatever. Like I think there's some interesting things there that you, which, and what we got was like a weird montage over a bad version of Smells Like Teen Spirit. And I again blow that up and put that on Disney Plus, and I think this movie would be better for it. But they obviously, this was like Scarlett's last hurrah as far as MCU stuff goes. Like, I don't think we'll see her very much anymore. So
yeah, she wants out, you know, which is fine. But, you know, luckily, like there are other people. It's just weird, like thinking about the MCU as this weird thing actors get to join up for, to free themselves to do whatever they want for the rest of their lives, is like kind of a fun idea. Cause now like Florence Pugh, you know, this won't make that much money, but she ends up in like one of the Avengers movies. She makes Avengers money then, and she can do as many Midsummers as she wants for the rest of her life.
Yeah.
You know, like that will just, you know, the same thing. Like it was when I had this like sense of like happiness when Paul Rudd got cast, I was like, you know, that's not like the kind of movie I like Paul Rudd in, but I like him and I want good things for him, you know? And now he just gets that Avengers money.
Yeah. Now he gets Ant-Man money, like, so he can do whatever the fuck he wants to. So
yeah, for the rest of it, you know, good for him from a creative standpoint.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think it's a good use of money, like in a class war standpoint, but from a creative standpoint, I like the idea of David Harbour and Florence Pugh, and Julia Louis-Dreyfus, like being able to just like, oh, I've been in the Marvel shit, so I get to do what I want.
Yeah.
Now
I feel like, I mean, hopefully Julia's getting paid on that fucking Seinfeld residuals, right? Like,
oh, she totally hopefully. Is like, all of these people are actually okay. Yeah. That's why I was saying, like, in a class war sense, like this is ridiculous, because, you know, these people are all fine. I shouldn't be wishing for them to have more money.
Except Paul Rudd, because that ageless bastard deserves every piece of happiness he can get,
it's
I guess.
Very nice. That bit he has with Conan O'Brien where he continuously shows him, that is so good.
The most recent one with Bill Hader, when they come out and they're arguing about how bad whatever bit that Bill Hader was talking about, like it was so fucking, and then of course that comes on and Conan loses his mind. It's awesome.
I also was losing my mind. So fucking good.
Well, let's wrap it up. So at the end of this, hey, we're all splitting up. We're all going to be a spy family, but not really a family anymore. We're just going to all split up. And, we get the post credit sequence of finally somebody, mourning Black Widow in the MCU universe.
they relegated her funeral to her own movie.
Yeah.
Post credit scene in her own movie.
I'm still just floored that, Iron Man gets this enormous, everybody in the MCU shows up, including that one guy from Iron Man 3 that you don't even recognize because he's 8, because he's hit puberty since then.
He managed to cancel softball practice to appear in that cameo.
And I just, man, like, and basically nothing for Black Widow, who, again, I've never particularly liked, but like, sacrificed just as much as Iron Man did in that movie to make sure that, to save the world. And got nothing for it. And to see that her grave is just, daughter, sister, Avenger. I just really wanted to see any other Avenger walk up and be like, daughter and sister? Excuse me? What? I knew the Avenger thing, but I didn't know any of this. Like, even Hawkeye is probably like, what? Since when?
Yeah. Those people we killed? Yeah, it is very it is a funny thing in a dark way about having that thing, and I like this, but the implication was cool. The actual setup, Julia Louis-Dreyfus showing up as the employer for new Black Widow, that's cool to me.
Yes,
it's been going on for a while, so presumably quite a bit before this happens, before Winter Soldier, or not Winter Soldier, U.S. Agent gets recruited as well. So she's definitely putting together some Thunderbolts, which I am 1000% in for.
Me too.
And then the idea of her like, hey, do you want to take out Hawkeye? Hawkeye did not kill Black Widow. Hawkeye tried his absolute best to stop her from dying. I know saying good things about Hawkeye gets people mad at you online because people hate Hawkeye, but it's just definitively not
true.
It'll
get people mad at you on this podcast if you're not careful.
Yes. But I'm right.
I do. Yeah, absolutely.
But I reckon, mm-hmm. like, the idea of her twisting it, like, people don't know what the hell happened on the planet of the Red Skull's soul sacrifice. So her twisting the story, is a really cool idea.
Oh, yeah.
Like, this is the last person to see her alive. He was always really selfish. Like, you operate in that spy mentality. You could see that, right? Like, he just did what needed to be done to save the world and thus killed your sister. I really like the idea of her using misinformation to put together these Dark Avengers or what have you.
Me too. And again, like Florence Pugh enough to want her to see her and more stuff. And this is leading directly into the Hawkeye series, which is going to be coming soon and going to introduce Kate Bishop and hopefully we'll kill Hawkeye. Mm-hmm. That's the best thing that could happen out of it. I enjoyed all of this. I read an analysis online because I got real big Clueless vibes off of Yelena's outfit here. I don't know if you kind of got that too. Like, she's wearing like a bunch of weird clothing that I was kind of taken aback by. And someone was saying that, like, oh yeah, that's because, she's not constantly being mind controlled now. And she's, not in war, so she can wear whatever the fuck she wants to. So like, this is the first time she could like wear her own clothes and her own style and everything, so I thought that was neat.
And also Russian ladies dress like 90s American ladies
constantly. Yeah, of course.
There's that joke about it in Venture Brothers as well, like it just that's a trope.
And I thought the bit about the jacket that Yelena gives mm-hmm. Natasha at the end, and of course, like, if you go back and watch Infinity War and Endgame, that's the jacket that she's wearing throughout all of those movies. It's a neat little touch, like a neat little mm-hmm. thing that they picked up. But I don't know, I can't imagine that was on purpose during Infinity War and Endgame filming, but like, it's a neat way to tie all that stuff together. So
yeah. It's interesting learning about reading about the development of this movie, because they were like, yeah, the first draft came together in 10 days, like it was so easy to write, which usually doesn't happen.
Yeah.
With these things. As we talked about, like that wasn't all for the best. But some of the stuff that came together like that really neatly does feel like you know, a little blessed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like that worked, and it does seem like it was very effortless in how it came together.
Yeah, yeah. Completely okay movie. I think completely, you know, avoidable if you as an action movie, but if you're an MCU fan, I think, you know, it's an okay one of those films, and it's not, you know, absolutely a misery to watch unless you hate the MCU and you're watching it anyway because you got to talk about it online.
Yeah, you don't do that, guy. Like, you can avoid these things.
Yeah.
It's never been easier not to go to the movies.
I downloaded this movie illegally, and I do that on a regular basis. My internet sucks, so if I can download ahead of time, I can watch, you know, sweet 4K, blah 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 blah. And when the movie started, it did like the logo and everything was this weird black and purple color. And I've turned to Autumn. I'm like, I guess they're doing, like, they've never really done the Black Widow like purple thing, but like, I guess like it could be a Hawkeye thing. And it turned out the movie that I downloaded just had off with some weird color problem to it, so the whole thing looked like that. But I had the moment where I was like, because, you know, they've been doing like the Marvel Studios and Loki green at the beginning of that series. So I was like, well, maybe they're, this just seems weird.
That'd be bizarre.
yeah,
super bizarre.
So then I spent $30 so I could watch it on Disney Plus. So end of that story.
That's what happens when you you paid for your crime.
Exactly right. Like, yeah,
that. you had to pay for the full version.
Mm-hmm. You wouldn't steal this movie twice, would you?
Yeah, punish Snake. This is a weird thing, you know, in terms of recommending this. Like, this is worth your time, and then simultaneously also worth your miss.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if that makes sense. Like, don't feel pressured. It's not must see, but it's fun enough. Like, it also hit me at like a time, like, I wanted to go back to the movies and watch a solid B.
Yeah.
Of, you know, superheroes punching each other. It was like what I needed very much.
It's also one of those weird things where, like, if you're the type of person who is going to watch and potentially enjoy this movie, like, you've probably already watched and enjoyed it or already have plans to. Like, yes. I mean, I feel like at this point, especially with the MCU movies, either you're in or you're out. And or you're like out but still have to participate into for some weird way. So I think for most people, like, if you said, yeah, I would recommend it if you're into MCU movies, they're gonna be like, well, yeah, I'm into the MCU movies, I'm gonna watch every single one of them regardless. It is weird to, like, should you watch this movie? Like, I don't know, you already know if you need to watch this movie or not. Like, are you the only weird thing about this, and I think it's pretty interesting, is if you're doing like a chronological watch of the MCU, like starting with, you know, the first Avenger and then going to Captain Marvel, like that kind of order, coming into this fairly early and then knowing that Natasha dies at the end of Endgame is pretty wild. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, just very well. None of this stuff's gonna go anywhere.
But may actually work the opposite thing, where, like, after that you're just expecting her to die in every movie. She never does.
just the suspense is killing you.
Exactly.
If you like us, go to patreon.com/duckfeedtv. We would like that. Leave us a range of reviews on Apple Podcast or Podcast Addict, please.
Yes, do that. Tell your friends about the podcast. Put the podcast on Twitter, I guess. I don't know how to do any of this stuff. Like, tell your mom about it. Do everything you got to do.
Figure it out.
Yeah, fuck, dude. What am I supposed to do, the podcast and advertise it at the same time? Come on. It's a lot of work I'm doing.
It does feel like something that, it does feel like this is, we've done our part.
Doesn't Duckfeed have a guy for this? Can't we make David advertise a podcast for it or something? Isn't there a David? Is there still a David? There's still a David somewhere.
I think there's still a David. Okay. I don't know how to make him do stuff, though. You'll have to talk to Cole.
Cole is the David guy?
Or you can talk to David. It's one or the other. I don't know how to make him do stuff. Can I interest you in a win?
Is there an app?
Yeah.
Thank you for listening. Next week, or in the next episode, we'll be back on our Avengers versus X-Men grind, and where Black Widow is in it but barely speaks. So look forward to that. Bye.